I am Rob Kanaki with Northeastern University, and you guys are all here to talk about creating a separate network for critical infrastructure. And we're going to debate whether it's a good idea. I'm really actually quite impressed by the crowds that we have on a Friday morning of RSA for this topic. You're ruining my riff on the St. Crispin's Day speech, we few, we happy few, because we have almost 100 people in the room. So that means that this very old idea, this nugget of a notion of, hey, maybe we should have a separate network for critical infrastructure that nobody's really developed in almost 20 years of people suggesting it, is something that at least a lot of very smart people thinks worth spending an hour on. I've spent about 6 months digging into it, and it seems like a very good idea, and it seems like it would be very hard to do. To get beyond that level of analysis, we have a great panel here. Sharla Artz from Utility Technology Council, Peter Fuhr from Oak Ridge National Lab, who has spent far longer and far more money trying to understand this concept, and Samara Moore from Exelon, who is also an old government colleague of mine. So what I want to do is basically jump right in. I want to ask Sharla to talk to us about how do utility telecommunications work today. Then I want to go to Peter and ask him to talk about his project, sort of paint us the vision of what might be. And then I want to ask Samara to sort of tear it apart from her government experience and from her private sector experience, because she's vicious. So,
excuse me.
Charlotte,
I'll scoot down this way.
Give us the understanding in 5 minutes or less of how does all this work?
Yeah, 5 minutes or less. So thank you for being here this morning. I represent the Utilities Technology Council. We represent about 300, mostly electric, some natural gas, and a handful of water utilities, but specifically on their information and communications technology needs. So we thought it would be good to kind of baseline level set how utilities use communications networks right now, because even though I'd been in the energy industry for 20 years prior to coming to UTC, I really didn't fully grasp how foundational these communications networks are to grid reliable operations. So back in the 1940s, after World War II, as utilities started expanding their footprint, as we started electrifying more of the United States, they went to the commercial carriers and they said, these are our reliability requirements for communications networks. And the commercial carriers came back and said, we probably can't do that, or if we can do that, it's going to be really, really expensive. So most utilities, for those of you that don't know, are rate regulated if they are investor-owned utilities, public power utilities, basically those fees, those expenses are paid by the taxpayers, and if you're rural cooperatives, basically the meter, those that have the meter pay the expenses for investment. So the utilities realize that all these veterans returning from theater of operations that had communications networks, so they started building their own private communications networks, not relying on the commercial carriers. So those networks are a combination of wireline and wireless. Back in the day, it was copper, right? Increasingly, it's becoming fiber. The wireless at the time was pushed to talk mobile radios, right? So the reason why utilities need this really reliable communications network, for those of you that don't understand electrical engineering, it's a difficult topic. I don't understand it either. But the way to describe it is that in order to keep the lights on, the supply of electricity must be balanced with the demand for electricity 24/7 constantly. And if that balance does not exist, you then have variations in frequency or voltage. That variation then causes things to get degraded in the system, which can then lead to power disruptions and eventually cascading blackouts, such as happened in the Northeast in 2003. The control and protection of that balance is done by various sensors. You'll hear terms like supervisory control and data acquisition systems, which provide that situational awareness. But that protection and control has to happen in milliseconds because electricity delivery happens at the speed of light. So the reliability of that communication is imperative to keeping the lights on. As I mentioned, increasingly we're moving to fiber, but again, utilities struggle on a daily basis, if you will, with increasing kind of threats, not from cybersecurity, but just from interference with enhanced mobile operations and various spectrum bands that we have positioned ourselves as carriers transition from copper to fiber. There's some issues there for us, but again, interference-free communication, reliable communication is essential for grid reliability, which is why we've started looking at what are the alternatives. Oh, one other point I'll make before I'll turn it over to Peter, who can talk about why the alternatives we've been exploring, is when there are major events like a hurricane, oftentimes you'll hear things about black sky events, right? So that horrible once, hope it never happens event where equipment would be destroyed. In order to get the grid re-energized, you will have to have communications to bring that back up because there's a lot of technical syncing that goes on, and the precision of that synchronization of the various generators back to the grid will only be done with communications. So that's why we have been looking and exploring at how do we continue to enhance the robustness and reliability of these communications networks. And that's, I think, where you come in.
Maybe.
On your research.
Maybe so. I echo the same thing. Good morning. Friday morning, 8:30. You all were out rocking last night. I'm convinced of it. I can just see. We can dim the lights if you need to. Put on some soft music. It's okay. It's all okay.
No soft music.
Okay,
no
music.
No soft music.
Not at all. So, again, thank you, Rob. My name is Peter Fuhr. I work at Oak Ridge National Laboratory. It's one of the Department of Energy suite of national labs. We're the largest office of science national laboratory in the United States. I have about 5,000 colleagues. And we do all sorts of things. And a major point is we do not compete with the private sector, but we'll try to help the private sector along in certain particular cases. And that's where this one has come into play. So it's kind of interesting from my perspective. I have a big team. I'm representing a very large team that's involved with this stuff about just the topic that you saw that brings you here. Like, should we try to think about getting part of the critical infrastructure off the regular good old internet that's addictive and it's free? And the utilities are, you know, really working with this stuff. There's a lot to do, and we'll go into more of the details in a moment. But as I was walking around the showroom floor looking at all the fine exhibits and listening to this and this and this and this, which is great. I mean, all that's great. But there seems to be this, it's predicated on, okay, there's, let alone people, there's the internet. Oh no, bad guys can get to me. And to first order, it's easy to think, is there a way to get the critical infrastructure, in this particular case, as a Department of Energy site, let's work with the electric utilities. And can we get them off the internet? What are you talking about? Well, this is kind of tough. So we did a bunch of studies and talked to so many utilities, and some of you are here. And what we came up with particular reports about what is the amount of information being transferred across the internet by different flavors of electric utilities, just like you were saying, the little co-ops to other things, so all the way to big IOUs, big organizations, and try to figure out, is there a way to separate it? So what are we really talking about here? Well, I love the name of the project. It's funded from the Department of Energy. We started about 18 months ago with just an idea. Can we possibly do this? Because the economics can get nuts if you don't watch out. And here we go. And it looked like, well, you know, the first studies, it looks pretty good. A lot of discussions with all sorts of various experts on both the communication side, certainly in the cyber world, over here with sensors and systems, instrumentation itself, and then here come the utilities. They're all bundled together. Can we possibly do this? So this last year, we received DOE money, again, to specifically try to design an architecture, a network architecture that could support really large organizations, really large utilities communicating with each other. Now, going into this, I'm just going to assume, which is probably stupid, but I'm going to assume that you know what happened in Ukraine. Oh, man. And then what happened in Ukraine the second time? and the third time, and the fourth time, and the fifth time, and that thing is a playground. It's a training ground. And there have been all sorts of other instances where the electric grid or communications related to the operation of the grid itself have been compromised. So some of the products that are downstairs, great. You know, great, fine. We're looking for something radically different. Is it possible to do this? Here are some of the examples. So why should we just rely on standard levels of security and communications based on a TCP or UDP/IP architecture? Why should we do that? Let's go with the software-defined network architecture that has no domain names. It's the non-domain name architectures. Could we do this? Could we do exotic, more fundamental things, such as rely on physics itself? And can we rely on quantum and quantum communications? Can we actually do this to do what? To do key distribution between sensors and systems that are installed inside the grid itself. It's more along the lines of machine-to-machine communications. Can we do this? Well, I'm happy to report that working along with a company called Cubitech, Los Alamos National Lab, our national lab, Oak Ridge, at an electric utility in Chattanooga called EPB, we were demonstrating this a month ago. There's a recent Wired article that showed up this week or something like that. Go hit it if you're curious. So it's like, wait a second. If we can start to employ those sorts of technologies and maybe actually get it off the grid and not use the standard, you know, things that we need to try to secure all the bad behavior of humans when we're on the internet, maybe there's a way to do this. The project is called Darknet. And Darknet, we inherited the name, came out of the Department of Energy, and I also find it darn funny, walking around downstairs, yesterday, the day before, I'm hearing all these people, oh, the Darknet, the sky's falling. Well, that's our name of our particular project. We're funded this year at $10 million, and we're looking to do a demonstration activity of a lot of different sensors and systems, software, hardware systems, using all sorts of things. And going out of the gate, it's some of the large public marketing authorities, Tennessee Valley Authority, Bonneville Power Authority, et cetera, because they're more in the federal enclave, and can we prove this as a technology? We have some things underway. There's more to come, but I pass it to the real expert, and as I was told, the vicious one.
Thank you. Samara, can I just pause quickly? I just want to pull up Peter's slide. And Peter, do you want to do just 1 minute on what that jumble of wires
is? Sure.
And then we'll pass it to Samara.
Is that okay? Okay, thanks. Graphic, pretty simple. And what it's a notional diagram of where the dark optical fiber in the nation lies. Now, obviously, this is notional. We've done a pretty hefty study working with some other academic organizations. University of Wisconsin did a nice piece of work. We have other things that are in technology reports that have been delivered from the lab to the Department of Energy that are available. And again, as you can see in the legend in the lower right-hand side, it's just listing some of the generators and major assets of the electric utility grid infrastructure across the United States and where they are geographically located. And again, notionally, here's where optical fibers that was laid back in the aughts. So, you know, Level 3 and all these other, Kitaiko and some other companies were putting down optical fiber, and all of a sudden, the lasers and detectors and filters and, you know, DWDM came into play, and you didn't need to use all the optical fiber. So you know what? It's a buried treasure. Now, is it possible to use it? Here's an example. So outside of Phoenix, you'll see a generator. What is that? It's Palo Verde. It's our nation's largest nuclear complex. And it goes right by I-10, and there's some optical fiber that's available that could maybe vector back and forth. We're looking at, you know, small, it's like crawl, walk, run, small utilities into a regional thing, into a national scale. Is it possible to do this? That's what the diagram is hinting at. That was 90 seconds. Sorry about that.
No, no worries. No worries. And, you know, I'll echo the thoughts again. Thank you all for showing up for an 8:30 session. So I don't know about how vicious I will be, but I will throw in just some additional considerations that are worth really evaluating. As Rob said when we started out, this is an idea that's been around for quite a while. I think you may have said 20-year-old idea. And so as it's great that we have resources to support the funding of this, you know, the hope is that as we look at this idea, we really look at it in the context of not just how the grid is operating and running today, but also as our sector is being transformed digitally, What is the future of it? You know, taking into consideration different elements such as, you know, generation closer to the user and microgrids and such. From my history in the government and partnering with other utilities and working, I know that oftentimes we can work with the technology to solve the really hard problems, and I'm excited about this project. At the same time, it's really important that we start to work some of the policy considerations that go along with it. You know, I was going to talk about people, process, and technology. I think you've covered the technology part pretty well. And on the people side, I think you touched on that as well. You know, it is both the research, but making sure we've got the right stakeholders at the table and engaged with the utilities, the telecom engineers from the utilities, to really understand what does this really mean, and how does this, you know, impact the multiple modes of communications that are used, and are we evaluating, in addition, ways to improve the security and resilience of the other modes of communication that are actually really important to how the grid is being managed today and into the future. You know, from the funding side of things, and I think we'll get more into the questions, you know, is really starting to understand the cost. While we work on the technology and improve viability, the cost is a very real thing for us. If any of you have to, you know, manage your budgets and really make real risk decisions here, understanding not just what it would take to implement it, but what about sustaining it? And then what does that look like, again, as we are transforming as a market to be more digital? So with that, I think I'll pass it back to you, Rob, to answer some questions.
Sir, I want to put out two questions to all three of you, and then you can pick them up. One of the issues when the National Infrastructure Advisory Council made a recommendation, I think, last August or August before last, to look at this idea of developing a national dark fiber network for critical infrastructure. One of the things they noted was that many utilities have already made that kind of investment or are making that investment for their own utilities. So what's the state of that? What does it look like currently? What data is staying on those closed off networks? And then what needs to move between the generators, the distributors, the ISOs, and the other companies in the ecosystem? Is there in effect already essentially some enclaves, and part of this may be connecting them together?
Yeah. Do you want me to? Okay. So I'll jump in first, and mainly because back in 2017, really it started in the summer of 2017, so there is an organization called the Electricity Subsector Coordinating Council. So there is a presidential policy directive, Rob probably knows the number of that PPD, that established 16 critical infrastructures, right? And so each of those critical infrastructures has a private sector coordinating council and a government sector coordinating council. And they interact with their specific agencies, and they're the primary point of contact for critical infrastructure protection, strategic discussions, mitigation efforts, et cetera. They were formed so that they didn't have to have those conversations with their government partners out in the sunshine, which is usually the case, right? Given the sensitivity of the conversations that were happening, having those more private conversations was essential. So the Electricity Subsector Coordinating Council is a little unique, mainly because the electricity sector has been identified as one of those lifeline sectors, right? If the lights go out, the other sectors don't work. Transportation, water, even communications networks need power to actually operate. They were getting a lot of pressure from Congress, from the government, and so they recognized the need for some strategic leadership from CEOs, right? So these are 30 electric utility CEOs across the country, all business models of utilities, right? So there's cooperatives, Arkansas Electric Cooperative Corporation, Lincoln Electric Systems, which is a public power utility in Nebraska, and Tom Fanning of Southern Company. They represent the chair and the vice chairs of that ESCC. But that group has been noticing, based on various exercises that have been taking place, whether it be GridX, which is a nationwide electric sector, kind of like, yep, what happens when there's a really bad day, to some of the DOE, Department of Energy Clear Path exercises, there's this recognition of the importance of resilient communications. So what we did at the behest of the ESCC, UTC, is conducted a baseline survey to kind of understand the current state of how utilities are deploying communications networks, right? And as I mentioned, a considerable number of utilities have their own fiber networks. Now, this is usually going to be the bigger utilities. So think Pacific Gas and Electric, Dominion, Exelon, others. They have made the investment in fiber, mainly because utilities, unfortunately, as we think about expanding our communications networks to incorporate the data that we're going to use operationally from the distribution level, from smart grid devices, et cetera, we want those reliable communications. We face a lot of challenges at getting access to spectrum at the Federal Communications Commission. We are not their core constituency. They have a particular mission to allocate spectrum efficiently and effectively, and because of our challenges there, given the risk to reliable communications from not having that access to spectrum or having spectrum that may be opened up and shared with others, utilities are recognizing there's a cost benefit to having this fiber deployed. And what we saw from that survey is increasingly utilities are going to be moving that direction to deploying more fiber. What I want to amplify in terms of what Peter said is that the fiber we're deploying to critical substations or generators that are essential for keeping the lights on, the data that we have traversing over those fiber optic cables is not what you need for some of these other applications, right? So there's a lot of bandwidth in that fiber optic cable that we're not utilizing because, again, the data that we're using for grid reliability is not as significant as some of the other applications that are out there. So there is a lot of fiber that's already there. We also have a lot of licensed spectrum that we use for mission critical communications. But I think based on this survey, what we're seeing is this recognition of looking at some of these efforts that Peter's been focused on.
Yeah, it's nice. Thanks. Yeah, what she said. That's really it. So there's some other details. If I can just continue
please,
here. There are all sorts of studies that are out there. And one of the things is like, I'm always hesitant to put up this particular slide at different times because it says, oh, dark net equals fiber. No, there's much more than that. And so let's say that you don't have optical fiber and financially you're a utility of whatever your size is. You say, I don't want to do this. That's why we're trying to do a proof of concept through the power marketing authorities and see what it actually means in terms of cost benefit and other activities. There's a report that came out, maybe more like a position paper from 2 years ago from Morgan Stanley that factored heavily into different proceedings that were discussions that were taking place on the Hill. And it was how Morgan Stanley essentially came to the conclusion, from a financial or fiscal perspective, the current way that we are doing cybersecurity is not sustainable from a fiscal perspective. And they were arriving at certain places where technologically we're coming at the same thing. We, as in a lot of people, are coming at this idea like the current system is just not sustainable. Put in another firewall. Oh, come on, I can crack it in 20 seconds. Okay, put in an ill-named data diode, ill-named EE sitting here. There's always leakage current in the diode. Oh, my God. Anyway, so put that in, and there are other things associated with this. So financially, no, it's not sustainable. But we continue down the path, and there are a lot of exhibits downstairs that show that. That's fine. Let's say that you are a utility and you don't have optical fiber. Or it's not in your close by for last mile connectivity through some wireless, which is great. Okay, then what do? There's a panoply of other things that come with Project Darknet that says, let's do something simple, like rotating the IP address, IP WAN. So let's say it's rotating the IP addresses of the devices that are already inside your substation. And do it similar to what you computer science people, it's moving target defense. Just keep rotating the IP addresses around. And I hear network engineers, the DNS is going to get screwed up. It's demonstrated. We have this working in electric utility substations with Internet of Things IP addressable devices that can start rotating the addresses. Why? Moving target. It's just hard for the bad guys to find you. There are all sorts of things that are at play. And with Internet of Things, and here comes, as you were saying, distributed energy resources. Oh, my God, the attack surface is going crazy. And so we're thinking more in terms of machine-to-machine communications versus, look what somebody shouldn't have clicked on that picture inside their email. It's not that. We're looking at this other activity.
Yeah, I'll say I'm glad to hear that you mentioned that because I think the real benefit comes from understanding how can we make these different means of telecommunications more resilient and secure, and leveraging the new technology, leveraging cryptography.
Oh, yeah.
There's so many ways that we can make those communication methods that are work well, are accessible, and maybe more cost effective than all fiber is an important part of it. So.
Oh man, I so agree with that.
Yeah.
There are studies, if I can go one more time.
Oh, please.
There are some studies out there, in case you're curious, like I'm dabbling in this. Again, I was hearing this conversation. Somebody with a microphone at booth N downstairs said, oh, the grid's going to go out. And like, oh my God, here comes, Armageddon. Okay, fine. There is a nice report that came out, and it's from the Department of Energy, hence big surprise. And it is the multi-year program plan for cybersecurity of energy delivery systems. And you want to see what the heck is what DOE itself, not just one project, there's a whole suite of projects that are trying to address it. It's a really nice review. And it references NIAC and many other things, NERC, all sorts of other programs and projects that are all intersecting. And you can get the stuff. Again, multi-year program plan for cybersecurity of energy delivery systems. If you have real questions, just send them to that guy on email, and they'll line you up with all the links. It's worthwhile. It's a worthwhile read if you're thinking about cybersecurity and the needs that are there specifically for energy.
So I'm gonna go back to Samara for a second. Sorry, what's that?
There's a question.
Can you give us about 5 minutes and we will get to questions? I want to go back to Samara for a second on what I think is sort of one of the analogies that is often used in this space. If you look at the history of this idea, a lot of it comes out of NSA, a lot of it comes out of congressional testimony when the Director of National Intelligence will be testifying about threats to the grid, and then a senator or congressperson will say, well, what do you think we should do about it? And the sort of fallback answer is, well, we want to think about doing something like this, creating this separate network. Where that comes from, in my view, is right that experience. For those of you who have worked in the military or the civilian government on cybersecurity, you probably had clearances and you probably worked on classified networks that were, to one degree or another, separated from the public internet. And so it's this kind of analogy of, can we take the idea of CIPRNet or JWIX and create a network that will fundamentally not be routable to the public internet? So, Samara, I want to go to you because you've got the experience both on the inside in government and on the outside in the utilities. How does that analogy translate to the utility world?
Yeah. So, just to take a pulse for a second, those of you in the room, are any of you familiar with working in classified environments? Okay, quite a few of you. So some of this may resonate with you. You've probably had the joy of not being able to contact anyone while you're sitting in a SCIF, or be contacted by. But there are some differences, some similarities, but some differences in the analogy. From the classified networks and environments, a significant part of that is around confidentiality. Confidentiality with a big C, all caps. For the utilities, while confidentiality is important, for us it's the integrity and availability, the big I, the big A. And there are ways in which you may be able to leverage technology and advances in technology to accomplish that high degree of integrity and availability that may not come at the same cost as it takes to manage and maintain networks similar to the classified environment. So there's some similarities there, but when you start to look at the cost considerations for a fully closed network, and then some of the capabilities that you may not be able to take full advantage of as a result of that.
So one, I think, interesting aspect that probably many of you are thinking about right now is it's not exactly like these separate networks are impervious to cyber attackers, certainly not from insider threats, Snowden, Manning, incidents going back to 2008 or earlier. If you walk the floor, as I guess Peter has, you'll see a lot of companies that are declaring the perimeter is dead in cybersecurity. And yet, in some ways, what we're talking about here at one level is how do we essentially create a perimeter around these utilities? So Peter, I'll push it to you because you look like you totally disagree with that. And so.
Yeah, that's my general persona. Yeah, indeed. So there are various things. Defense in depth has, of course, been plugged around for quite a while. And that's always a good avenue. It's a good avenue. You know, if nothing else, you can think of it like, okay, there's a lot of trees here and you're going to somehow have to navigate your way through the forest. So put those security little boundaries. Is it pushing the boundary? Is it increasing it? Is it less than that? No, I don't think it's changing at all. Honestly, I don't. I just think it's you try to make it more difficult for the bad guys to get to what they're after, which in the utility setting, it's timing, data, and then, of course, you know, other things, maybe a decision, maybe an action, actually do something. So if we can make it more difficult for them to get to that particular actionable point, away we go. Does it actually change the boundary? I don't think so. I don't think so. We vetted this with so many electric utilities. Of course, the ones that have provided the electrons here. So here we go, PG&E and Dominion and Duke and Southern or SoCal Edison and San Diego Gas and Electric, thank you, Corey, and Commonwealth Edison and Consolidated Edison and just up and down the street. And we have about 75 partners right now and 900 electric utility co-ops. They're all invested, like let's explore this as a possibility. Both from a fiscal perspective and then also, hey, maybe it is a cybersecurity perspective, away we go. I want to give a 90-second thing, quick description about the Electric Power Board, EPB in Chattanooga, because they're really rocking it. And what they did was, my perspective, which is the right perspective, it was, okay, we're going to leverage ARPA-E money, back stimulus package money back in the day. We're going to leverage that to actually put optical fiber throughout the city. And they did this. And ostensibly, it was run, the proposals came in to DOE and other places. Great, and they got a bunch of money, and they were able to leverage a municipal bond, they're a muni. So, you know, here you go, leverage the bond with the federal money, put optical fiber to every one of their customers, like 210,000. Optical fiber drop, what do you get for that? Well, 2 gigabits per second, 500 channels, phone, of course, how much? $99 a month. So this is really something different. They got waivers from the FCC to be able to actually deploy or deliver internet-like services or cable TV into their electrical geographical region. Why do I mention that? Because they also had drops at every one of the substations, every pole, every everything. So as you were saying, with fiber, you got like essentially an infinity sign sitting there in terms of bandwidth. Mm-hmm. And the requirements you have for electric utility stuff is it's not bandwidth intensive, it's latency intensive. Like determinism, if possible, here you go. Hence the network fabric has to change from just, you know, generic Ethernet to other things. It's a slightly different world, and EPB is doing all that.
Well, and I want to amplify that, because the results of their, quote, experiment, right? So the economic development impact to that region has been phenomenal. So this is kind of a little off topic, but I'll get back there soon. But importantly to this discussion, their response and recovery rates from storm outages, et cetera, have increased significantly because of this fiber network. I want to point out, as I was mentioning earlier, the challenges utilities face as they're exploring the importance of these private networks that they have for their mission critical communications. There are states all over the country, because the carriers don't want the competition, where public power entities like Chattanooga are not allowed to have fiber networks. They're not allowed to take that fiber capacity that they have and do what they've done in Chattanooga, which is just a shame, right? So anyway, that's a personal.
So, and I want to kind of coming back to the question on, is the perimeter changing, and challenge that a little bit.
Sure.
And I'd be interested in your thoughts, as we do have, new market entrants or non-traditional players in the market that are now generating power and putting it into the grid. So do you not see that as part of our perimeter changing and different or increased services, attack services there?
I stand corrected. There you go. It's a good way to look at it. DER is its own beast, you know. And you put sensors out there, they're supposed to communicate with the grid, sort of, more than just what the meter is, so you know you get a return on what your solar power investment was. I think you're right.
And I'll just add one more thing to the perimeter question. Sorry, just because I was thinking about this as Peter was talking, and then I got on my little soapbox about bridging the digital divide. But anyway, utilities, part of, I think, the reason why maybe the perimeter isn't changing is that we actually have reliability requirements, but it's also the way that we engineer the system. That your communication network, whether it be on fiber or whatever, is not, you're not just gonna have one network, right? You're gonna have a backup to a backup. And sometimes you're gonna have a backup to a backup to a backup, because there's recognition that whatever facility or the communication coming from that particular facility is so essential that you don't want that to have that be your single point of failure. So
I think it's just kind of pulling the thread on this discussion. As we have these new market entrants, I think our challenge is gonna be to involve them in the discussion, because they're not always your traditional players. Right. But as we're getting more connected, I think making sure that they understand the significance and understand what is their role in critical infrastructure, even if it's just locally, will be important.
Yeah. So I want to go to questions now. I think we had one there. We have microphones. Quick guidelines: if you're willing, state your name and affiliation. If you're not, so be it. And please try and be brief and ask a question.
And financial services, worry about systemic risks. I notice on the map, there's a lot of concentration on the perimeter, and of course, we worry about climate change and the impacts there. So I was curious about how you think about how the map may change over time. And in addition, are there, for this potential solution where we optimize use of the fiber more, are there implications for locations of, say, data centers and things like that? Curious.
Should I attempt this? That's a super question. There was a recent study in the last year that was looking at what sea level change right in the south end of Manhattan and what it's going to actually impact in terms of the communication fabric that's underground right there. And I think that you're right. I think there'll have to be some sort of distortion or moving from where the little triangles are and the circles for generators and substations. That's not me. That's utilities. Where's the opportune place to actually, put your particular generator or big substation? Undoubtedly, things are going to change, man. Because if you're right on the coast, it's happening. It's just happening. So I can actually see this. Again, it's a notional diagram. You can drill right in and get something that's much higher resolution on where stuff is and what it matters.
And I'll just, oh, sorry, did
okay.
I?
Go ahead.
So the Electric Power Research Institute is an organization that does a lot of research at the behest of electric utilities. And we're exploring right now how you could map or how you could pull together where utilities have laid fiber. Right? Obviously, there's going to be reluctance in sharing that information given the sensitivity of it. Right? We don't want people to know where to go and try and cut essential fiber, right? So, but there's, as Pete said, that's notional. There is a lot of fiber out there that is very sensitive, critical energy infrastructure information.
Yeah, or available for use.
Right, but
Rob, just hold on for a second. If I go back to this EPB thing again, because it's a good use case, and we'll get to the questions. It's a pretty good use case. So we've met with so many utilities saying, our SCADA system, operations technology, our OT system is separated from IT, there's no crossing the boundary. Yeah, good for you. There is a really good report, and then a good presentation delivered by a cyber researcher. His name is Eric Byers. Now, those of you, check him out. Byers was at the University of British Columbia, spun out a little startup, got acquired by Rockwell's. Really interesting stuff. And Byers has a really nice presentation on what's more probable, the presence of no connection between the IT and OT system. No, there's no separation, or a unicorn. And we're not talking financial VC unicorn, we're talking unicorn. So you'll see it's much more probable that unicorns exist than you truly have this separation. So to believe anything else is kind of crazy. Last thing about EPB, when they laid all this optical fiber, they're delivering the internet at a good rate. Their profit margin, this is my view of this, got the data. Their profit margin on selling electrons varies between 9 to 11%. So it's not that great. Selling the internet, 83%. So what they've been doing as a utility that's municipally owned is when they have like a substation that burns up for whatever reason, a storm or something like that, instead of going back to the city and asking for $1 million to replace it, they just go over to the bank that's making it over here on using the same optical fiber. But here's where the money is sitting. They can do this. They paid off their $355 million loan in 4 years, where they thought it was going to be 10 because they're making so much bank over here. It's a really interesting thing. Now, where does cyber come into play? If you're talking to the IT and OT network engineers that are running this particular utility, if somebody can start doing VLAN hopping, oh, baby, that's trouble. And it's because they're doing a separation between delivering all this stuff and here's the operation of the utility.
And I think that's why it's important to note that while there are, you know, segmentations, it doesn't mean that because the network is segregated or isolated that there are no protections within the private networks, because those protections exist. And in this, you know, scenario that's being assessed, we still would need protections internal because there are other threats that you want to manage internally.
I want to get these guys in.
Okay, Neil Ziering, NSA. Thanks for sharing your insights with us on this sort of technology area. We're discussing isolating or separating operational networks for utilities, and that's a cool thing, although it's, you know, the EPB examples may be a little unusual. But two specific questions about that. First, does each utility, in the vision that you guys are espousing, would each utility run their own isolated network, or would there be some sort of shared backbone where costs could be amortized for multiple utilities? And secondly, as you just pointed out, both of you, you can't totally isolate or totally separate these networks. There has to be some interaction between the operations of a utility and the business of a utility. And how would you protect those connection or contact points?
Thank you for those questions. Those are great. Straight up with Darknet, this is an R&D activity. So we don't have all the answers to that. We're working with Cybercom quite a bit and other things on those particular cases. Where does the rubber meet the road there between IT and OT? And it may just be in the database. So here comes the SCADA information, as you were mentioning. Here it comes in. It's telling here's how the grid is operating. But we do have to have billing and other services. And you know it's going to be hard to get off the internet when the public-facing part of the internet anyway. And those are to be determined. So we're not exactly sure. We can have a different discussion maybe at Fort Meade.
And I mean, the bulk power system right now is regulated, and we are meeting those requirements and doing that today, right? And always looking for ways to be more efficient in doing so. But, you know, that is being managed today. And so as these efforts, you know, progress and continue, you know, I expect that part, the security of those networks to continue and the ability to securely share information that's needed to the business side will continue as well.
So I just wanted to say, I want to emphasize that utilities right now, especially your larger utilities, own and operate their own private networks for mission critical comms, right? So that already exists, right, where they are not working with the commercial carriers. You know, they're going to be working with the commercial carriers, say, on their customer interfacing websites. But on those mission critical communications where it is essential that they have control because they can't rely on the level of reliability that the commercial providers are going to give to them, they've got their own private networks. And then I just lost my train of thought for the second part of what I was going
to
answer.
Add to it.
Okay.
As well, is that I also don't want folks to walk away thinking we're just focused on compliance, because we are heavily regulated by NERCSIP, but, you know, there is an increasing recognition, but not just a recognition, but action and resources being put to going beyond compliance and managing the risk to the business and to the organization. So compliance is a significant part of that, but we're also managing cyber for our critical business systems. And so that is actively being worked. And again, that's why events like RSA are so good, because we get to find ways to be on the cutting edge of doing that. But managing cyber risk holistically, both our regulated space and our unregulated space, is particularly important and a focus of of the utility industry as well.
So the train just rolled back into the station. So the other part of my thought was that there are 18 reliability coordinators across the United States right now that have Essential for Balance doing that balancing, right, that I talked about. And they have a secure communication network that they utilize to communicate with each other on a daily basis, right, minute by minute basis, but also then for those incidents. To that end, again, if, say, that network would go down, there is an effort underway right now within the Electricity Subsector Coordinating Council called the Resilient Communications Working Group. It's spearheaded by PJM, which is one of the largest regional market coordinators, if you will, but not, they're not just market coordinators, regional transmission organizations. Dominion is a part of that, Southern Company is a part of that, and the New York Power Authority is a part of that. So that should we have one of those black sky events or really, really bad days, how is New York Power Authority going to connect with PJM, going to connect with Southern Company so that we can re-energize portions of the grid to start then getting the power back on to various populations and major metropolitan? And that would probably largely initially be a wireless type of effort, right? So radio communication, some combination. We actually kind of call it the MacGyver, how we MacGyver our way out of this, right? Knowing that some portion of your traditional communications are not going to be available to you. And then the subsequent part will be looking again at this dark net aspect as well. So there are things that are occurring already, even as we're envisioning this communications network of the future.
I want to make sure we get
one more question.
This last thing, what about the cloud? So as SCADA systems are starting to go with the cloud, it's like all you can do is man whatever hours that are being applied, go to the cloud, SCADA in the cloud. Wait a second. So we're looking at the communication fabric again, and this is just something to be knowledgeable about. We got the cloud, we got IoT, we got distributed energy resources, we have boundaries and geographical and financial boundaries, et cetera. There's lots of things that are at play.
Yep. Sir.
So I can build a little bit off of that. Timothy Johnston, Hack of Defense. So I'll be as inflammatory as possible. Have we looked at China? Because they have a sort of an any means possible. Something breaks, they go, what can we use? Have we sort of looked at that?
So I will chime in at a high level to say that the sector is, so Sharla talked about the ESCC, Electricity Subsector Coordinating Council. They're get regular classified briefings, the DHS and other partners from the community, intelligence community work with electric utilities to share relevant information. And I know that our national labs are also tied into that, so that way awareness of those threats inform the work that's being done and the research that's being done. So there are connections to stay aware and hopefully be informed by what's going on there.
So my simple answer at Oak Ridge National Lab, on behalf of that, yes. Yeah, we're aware. And also then, you know, the whole thing about hit the news a week or two ago, oh, look, you know, Russia's going to try to run their own intranet, that is the internet. And a lot of that impacts the critical control systems in automation, not just utilities, but automation itself. Quite aware of that. That is a good question.
Joe Weiss, last question in a minute or less than a minute to answer.
And as much as anything, a comment. And by the way, Richard Clark came to me in 2001 and 2002, when I was at EPRI, asking this question. You know, how can we get a separate network for the utilities? But the real thing I've got is we have no security or authentication and our basic process sensors. In other words, what's input to every system? So the question really is, if you can't trust what you measure, how can you make sure you're secure or reliable?
Joe, it's good to see you. Good to see you. You always ask like off the wall questions, man. Here you go. So that is a core tenet of what we're trying to do with Darknet. I'm right on the soapbox here, and it's the following. Like, wait a second. I could sit here. We call them cyber aware and cyber responsive sensors that are measuring the parameters and the operational characteristics of the grid itself, but also what the heck is going on over here in cyber world. because there's a parallel that's happening back and forth. And it hits, we had a meeting in DC on Tuesday that was specifically about that point. How can we actually trust or authenticate that the device is correct, the device is authorized, let alone is the value good? So what else comes in? What else comes into play there? Oh, what's the latest, greatest thing last year? Starts with a B, seems like it's two words put together, we call it blockchain. So that comes into play also as an authentication mechanism and a way to distribute the PI historian from a central repository into 2 weeks of data that's throughout the network. There are lots of things that are here much beyond this 90-second.
We're getting our termination signal so we can take the conversation.
I'll meet you outside.
I'll take
out
you outside.
Into the hallway. That has been the request. I want to thank our panelists.
Sorry about that.